Okay, everybody, good morning, buenos días. I am Silvia Pedraza, for now president of the Association for the Study of the Cuban Economy, that we call affectionately ASCII. I welcome you to the 29th reunion of ASCII. That's a long, long time, all of which has always had proceedings from the conference, and they are up on the website, and all of the proceedings have always been called Cuba in Transition. So it's 29 years of Cuba in transition. We're not sure what the transition is from what or to what, but but we are in a transition. I was thinking last night a lot about what to say to you this morning about ASCII. I think that most of you share the same feeling that I have, that one of the most important things that ASCII does is to actually make a bridge between the people here and the people in Cuba, okay? I learned that from a very good friend of mine in Cuba, El Padre José Conrado Rodríguez, who many, many years ago said to me that the people inside and the people outside, the good people inside and the good people outside, should join hands. Que se den las manos, los buenos de adentro y los buenos de afuera. And I think that that is what we try to do in ASCII. We try to do it intellectually, we try to do it personally, we try to do it emotionally, we try to do it by bringing good people from Cuba to participate in the conference. We try to do it in a lot of ways, and this year has been a very difficult year for us to be able to achieve that, because ASCII has gone through several crises, not the least of which was the loss of funds from the Christopher Reynolds Foundation. And now what is really a very complicated and difficult political environment of who is allowed to leave Cuba and come to the United States or not, the visa problem, okay? And so the two things together have been a remarkable year for ASCII, okay? If the fact that we're here, that we have had as much success in bringing as many people as we have managed to bring from Cuba and other countries is thanks to all of you. It's thanks to the members of ASCII who stepped up and helped us with their donations. I'm going to tomorrow in the business meeting, please come to the business meeting. It's a short business meeting. And I'm going to read the names of the people who gave donations to ASCII, because they are the ones that enabled us to put the reunion together this year. But I want everybody to know that we are most grateful to them, because without their help, we would not be putting on this conference this year and continuing to achieve the goal of having the good people inside of the island and the good people spread throughout the diaspora join hands. Okay, so this morning we're going to begin our session with the work of Carmelo Meza Lago. I am extremely, extremely pleased that we decided to name the plenary session, this session. We had never done this before, and we have named it in honor of Carmelo, okay? So that it will not only now, but from henceforth, be called the Carmelo Meza Lago Opening Plenary, okay? And so this is our way of honoring one of our best colleagues, not the only one. If we had more room in the program, I would put honor more people, but we have done what we can with the program that we have, and this plenary will, from henceforth, be called the Carmelo Meza Lago Opening Plenary. Carmelo is Distinguished Service Professor Emeritus of Economics and Latin American Studies at the University of Pittsburgh. He has been a visiting professor and researcher in 8 countries and a lecturer in 39. In addition, he was the founder editor for 18 years of the journal Cuban Studies. He has been the author of 95 books, pamphlets, and 318 articles, chapters, published in 7 languages in 34 countries, about half of them on Cuba's economy and social welfare. It really is an extraordinary production. His most recent books are Cuba Under Raúl Castro, Assessing the Reforms, and this is a book that he did with Jorge Pérez López. Here's Pérez López with the red guayabera. I was looking for the red guayabera.
You stand out in the crowd.
Yeah, it's great. It's a great color. He is also the main author of Voices of Change in Cuba, University of Pittsburgh Press, 2018, and what is for me, nice about this book, among other things, is the fact that Carmelo has, like most economists, always worked. He has worked with a lot of data, statistics, numbers, and so on. But in this book, he actually interviewed people, and he was fascinated by how much he learned from participant observation and from interviews. Okay, so it's a methodological departure in his work, and it pleases me a lot because I also had a similar transition in my own work many years ago, and I was astonished at how much one learns from actually being there, living what people are living, speaking with them, listening to them above all. Carmelo has also worked throughout Latin America as an ECLAC regional advisor and has served as a consultant with most international financial organizations, several United Nations branches, and foreign foundations. Carmelo was president of LASA, Latin American Studies Association. He is a member of the National Academy of Social Insurance, and he has received numerous awards. Among them are the ILO International Prize on Decent Work. This is a prize that he shared with Nelson Mandela. The Alexander von Humboldt Stiftung, I think it is, Senior Prize. Two Senior Fulbrights, the LASA Award on Excellence on Cuba, the Arthur Whitaker and Hoover Institution Prizes, the Distinction of ASCII, and homage for his life work on the Cuban economy. He was also selected among the 50 most influential Ibero-American intellectuals of 2014. So today, Carmelo is going to do something very synthetic that we can all benefit from, and that is to talk to us about the Cuban economy after six decades of revolution. Now, please help me welcome Carmelo.
First of all, thank you very, very much for naming the plenary with my name. It's really a great honor for me. This, and also for the organization of this panel, to Silvia, Jorge. It's a real pleasure to be here again. By the way, I didn't do interviews in Cuba. They were done by two Cuban social scientists, Lenier Gonzalez and Roberto Vega, who were the editors of Cuba Posible, something that have to be shut down because of government pressure, and they are in a terrible situation. I hope in any way that you can help them, that would be great. So the task, as Silvia said, is almost impossible, but how can you summarize 60 years of the Cuban Revolution? Well, I will do in some cases. In other cases, I will refer to the year 1989, because it's a crucial year. It was the year before the big crisis, also called the special period in time of peace. Okay, so changes between 1958 and 2018, some of them are positive, others are negative, something are neutral or mixed. The market system shifted to a centrally planned economy, one of the most centralized physical planning in the world today. Perhaps the only one will be North Korea. State enterprises, I just want to take my time. Okay.
Don't worry, we have time.
Okay, all right. A strong predominance of state enterprises, collectivized agriculture, sugar dependency, that was before the revolution, it was 75% of total exports and 22% of GDP. These have been replaced by services, which now account for 80% of exports and 12% of GDP. The most important service is professional services, which are exported by Cuba. They jump from zero to $7.6 billion, and it's the first source of hard currency in Cuba. And then come foreign remittances, which increase from virtually nothing to $3.5 billion. That's the second source of hard currency in Cuba. And then the third source of hard currency is tourism. The number of tourists jumped 18 times, and tourist revenue 53 times. Oil production rose 79 times. and dependency on imported fuels decreased from 99% with the Soviet Union to 50% today. Although I would show that there have been a decline since 2010. And then social services shifted from partly private and mostly limited to urban areas to a state-owned, operated, universal, and free. But there are negative factors too. The most important one is external debt. It jumped 190 times. That was before a successful condonation by creditors that happened in the recent years. And then population growth. Sergio Diaz-Briquez is going to talk about this extensively tomorrow. But it went down from positive 2.1% to minus 0.2%. And the problem with this, of course, this is good because people live longer, but financially speaking, it's a disaster because the cost of pension and health care, among other things, as the population ages, becomes higher and higher. Now, what about the continuities? If you ask me, which is the constant in all these years of the revolution, 60 years, I would say that it's the incapacity of the system to generate appropriate, sustainable growth and to finance imports with their own Cuba's exports without foreign substantial subsidies. I would talk about this in a minute. So that you have a general idea, this dependency has a long history. With the USA, it was 52% of total export. It increased tremendously with the Soviet Union to 72%. And finally, with Venezuela, at the peak, it was 44%. So less than with USA and with the Soviet Union. In the 30 years between 1960 and 1990, Cuba received from the Soviet Union $65 billion. To put this in the Latin American context, this is three times what all Latin America received from the Alliance for Progress of John F. Kennedy. Three times, Cuba alone. And of course, the disappearance of the Soviet Union created the big crisis of what the Cubans euphemistically call the special period in time of peace. This relationship was based on heavy subsidies to prices by the Soviet Union. For instance, the price of sugar was as much as seven times the world market price. The price of nickel was 50% above the market price, and the price of oil, 99% supplied by the USSR, was below the market price. So this was a heavy subsidy, and the bulk of these $65 billion were these subsidies that, of course, you didn't have to pay back. In relation to Venezuela, the peak was between 2012, I would show that, and 2013, and all trade goods and services were 22% at the peak of GDP. So 28% was the Soviet Union. It is very substantial dependency, but certainly much less. The most surprising thing is, despite this huge economic policy, particularly subsidies and Raúl Castro reforms, which unfortunately didn't have any tangible economic effects, Cuba's inefficient economic model that has failed elsewhere has had a dismal performance. And I am going to show you several indicators of this. The first one is GDP growth. I'm sorry, but the pointer doesn't work, and you won't be able to see that either. But if you look at that, at the peak in the left, that was 12% growth in that year. It went down to a low of 1%, and then in between 2016 and 2018, it averaged 1.1%. That's a stagnation. By the way, the figure for 2018, the official figure, not published yet, but given by the Cuban authority was 1.2%. But last week, President Díaz-Canel doubled it. So it's now 2.2%. It didn't explain, and we don't have the data yet, but even with that increase, it's not significant. This year, the target is 1.5%. Most Cuban economists say this is impossible to achieve, although the president and the minister of economics says that they will try. Now, compare this about 1.2% average. The target set by the government is 5 to 6 times that, 5 to 6% of GDP, in order to have sustainable growth. So this is a real problem for Cuba. Now, in the second indicator, we have two variables. The first one is gross capital formation, which is the blue line on the top. And this is very important because as higher gross capital formation is, higher economic growth should be. And what you see here, except for the year 2008, which is the peak there, that's almost 15%, it goes down, and in the last 7 years, the average has been 9%. So, but in comparative terms, in 1989, it was 25%. Now nine, it was 25%, and this is precisely the rate that the government said is essential to achieve sustainable economic growth. And then the second curve, which is with the orange one, that's the fiscal deficit. And as you can see, it started very low at 3.2. At one point in 2013, which is that trot over there, it was 1.3, and it increases last year to 11%. This is one of the highest deficits since the crisis of the 1990s. And now, I did this indicator, which is monetary liquidity in the population hands of so-called M2, because I don't trust data on inflation in Cuba. To begin with, Cuba have never published the basket of goods and services, which is essential to measure the consumer price index. And second, very importantly, is that all transactions done in convertible pesos, CUC, are not included there, and therefore is grossly underestimated. So this is a surrogate. And what it is, surplus money in circulation. And as higher this is, it's an indication that, oh, I forgot to say that there are central prices in Cuba, so that's another problem with the official rate of inflation. Now you can see what happens here is that there was a peak during the worst year of the crisis, 1993, you can see it there, and that was 73%, the highest under the revolution. And then it goes down to 34.1, if you trot over there, in 2004, but it's increasing steadily. And in 2017, we don't have the data for 18, it won't be available probably until November or December, it's almost 54%. So that is comparable with the rate of 1992 and the rate of 1994 during the crisis. For me, this is more important than the rate of inflation. Okay, and finally, this is the index of physical industrial output. Oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you something very important. These figures are not mine. I mean, the tables and the figures I did, but all the statistics come from Cuba, Oficina Nacional de Estadística e Información, or NEI. So I have everything that I show here you is our official data. And this is quite important too, because as you can see, this is an index, so the first year is 100, and everything is related to the index year. And this goes down in 2006 to 38%, but it is increasing since then, and by 2017, the same figure for 2018, I just checked it yesterday, and could put it in the figure. So there is a recovery, but if you compare 2017 or 2018 with year base, we are talking about 32 percentage points below. That means that on all this year, Cuba has been unable to recover the level of industrial output that it had prior to the big crisis. There are other effects on the Cuban economy. Mining has declined in 7 consecutive years. That includes oil and nickel, which are the 2 most important mining products. Sugar output in 2018-2019 was 82% below 1989. And then I have measured the performance of the 13 most important output indicators in terms of agriculture, cattle, and fishing. And output in 2017 was lower than in a peak achieved somewhere between 2009-2017. 7 of those 13 products in 2017 were below the level of 1989 before the crisis. So you can see that this is a dismal economic performance, according to the Cuban figures. And the cause, I have said already, is the inefficient economic model, central planning and state enterprises predominant over the market and private property. Cuba have not, and I doubt, followed the successful Chinese-Vietnamese model of market socialism, which have been quite successful for more than a decade. Okay, now I am going to show you, I will show you, but you won't see it because it's very small, but I will try to describe this for you. This is a total economic relationship with Venezuela. The only thing that is not there is investment, direct investment, because some of the projects materialized, others didn't. But the first curve, the one at the top, which is the blue one, is the total of all the economic relationship. And the others below are the different components. I should say that this is from a paper that I did with Pavel Vidal Alejandro, which, if you want, is available from Instituto, Real Instituto del Cano, de Estudios Internacionales. I think it is at cano.com. The whole paper is there, but it's based on that. So you can see all of this curve, there is a peak and then there is a decline. And the total, the peak is $16 billion in 2012. And then it goes down to $8 billion in 2017. That's a decline of 50%. And the component, the most important one, of course, is the selling of professional services, mostly doctors, and mostly to Venezuela, about 75% to Venezuela, is the orange curve after that. And the peak is in 2013, $7.6 billion. It goes down to $5.8 billion. That's a decline of 24%. And then the third one, which is the gray, that's fuel supplied by Venezuela. And that the peak there is $6 billion in 2012, and it goes down to $1.8 billion. That's a decline of 70%. And by the way, at the peak of the relationship in this year, Venezuela was supplying Cuba 105,000 oil barrels per day. This year, the latest figure that we have from Jorge Piñon is 30,000. So that's a big, significant decline. And to compound the problem, Cuba's oil output domestically have declined 17% between 2010 and 2017. So you have a combination of a decline of external fuel from Venezuela and Cuban output. And that has an impact on industry, on agriculture, and in part is responsible for very severe scarcity of food and consumer goods in Cuba now. Okay. I forgot to tell you that the exportation of professional services, there is an implicit subsidy, because what the Cuban government receives, not what is paid to the Cuban doctors in Venezuela, because they receive only a fraction, what Cuba Venezuela pays to each Cuban physician is 7 times what an average Venezuelan doctor received. So here is the subsidy, the same way that the Soviet Union subsidized exportation of raw materials, sugar, and nickel. Okay, and then finally, the yellow curve is this is a non-oil trade of goods, and that again there is a peak of 2,484 million, and it goes down to 376,000, which is a decline of 85%. That relationship, the total relationship in trade. Oops, I did something here. I think I knocked out the. Here it is. Cannot do it. So I was saying that that the relationship always results in a deficit, a trade deficit for Venezuela. So to give you an example, at the peak of the relationship, that trade deficit was equivalent to $3.5 billion against Venezuela. And that was another subsidy, obviously, because that's never is going to pay back. Okay, so the final thing, which is not in the table, in the figure, is investment. And as I said, some of these projects materialized, most importantly, the oil refinery in Cienfuegos. But I made an estimate in all this period of $8 billion. But that's not in the table. If you want to look at this in a simpler way, which is all this relationship, except for investment, direct investment, in relation to GDP in Cuba, you can see that at the peak, in the center, that was 22% of Cuban GDP. In other words, the value of that economic relationship was equivalent, tantamount, to 22% of Cuba's GDP. And it went down to 8% of GDP. That's 14 percentage points in this period. Now, a lot of people ask the question, is a special period the name that was given by the Cuban government to the big crisis of the 1990s, is it going to return? I don't think it's going to be, I mean, it will be a terrible crisis. It's already happening. This is the worst year since the crisis of the 1990s. But it won't be of the same magnitude of the crisis. Why? And the reasons are there. First of all, there are more diversified trade partners and investment. This is something that Raúl Castro mentioned in his speech when he talked about the crisis. Second, there is much higher hard currency revenue from tourism and foreign remittance. I explained that in the first slide. There is a decline in imported fuels from 99 to 50. And then the economic relationship as a whole with the Soviet Union, as I mentioned, was 28% of GDP. Now it is, now after the decline, meaning 2017, it is 8%, so it's a 20 percentage points lower. But all not is good, because I must tell you that all the data shows, statistics from Cuba, that the best economic point in Cuba was from 1985 to 1989. Both economically and social. Tomorrow, that's a little advertisement. I will be talking about social welfare, and you could see in detail what I am summarizing here. Whereas now, the economy, as I said before, is in the worst situation since the 1990s, and is facing a very significant scarcity of food and consumer goods. People have money. You saw that in the indicator of the monetary liquidity, but they cannot buy. You can't even have CUC or hard currency. You cannot buy many things, and that's the reason why they were put back in the rational system a few months ago. That was one of the principal goals of Raúl Castro reform, to eliminate the rational system. It was declining until that point in which the scarcity of goods forces them to put back in La Libreta several of these things. Okay. Now, what happens if Maduro falls? Well, you will lose another $8 billion. And that will be a shock. That will be a severe shock, not only GDP, but also in investment, which also related to the President Trump measures. I have shown that neither Russia nor China can replace Venezuela. I don't have time to do that, but you can ask, and I will give you some details about that. And finally, Trump's policies against Cuba, I don't have to go through this. You can see that in the paper with Pavel that I mentioned. For me, the most important one is the implementation or enforcement of Title III of the Helms-Burton law of embargo, blockade, whatever, of 1996, because this is going to generate a freeze or a significant slowdown in investment, and there are many, many claims presented in U.S. courts. The second one is tourism, which you saw, it was the third sort of hard currency. And the two most important measures here are, first, stop cruises. And this is very important because if you look at Cuban data, it shows that most tourists going to Cuba now are going through cruises, not by air. And therefore, that won't affect, of course, European and Canadian tourists, but it will affect American tourists. And the second one is to stop the people-to-people travel that was implemented by Obama during the normalization period. And that was the easiest way to go to Cuba. It was very easy. You went to the airport and there was a form and you just put an X and that's it. Now it's much more complicated than that. So the number of tourists is going to decline and the revenue is going to decline too. In my opinion, the top that President Trump put on selling remittances from Cuban Americans will be extremely difficult to enforce. We're talking about $4,000 per year. That's twice what President George W. Bush did. So Trump here, policy is tougher than President Bush. But it's extremely difficult to enforce because, you know, there can be several people sending the money, not one. So that top of $4,000, very, very difficult to implement. And that happened with George Bush top as well. Okay, and so ending alternatives. Raúl Castro's economic reforms was a decade from 2007 to 2017. As I said, did not have a tangible economic effect. Why? Because they were very slow, submitted to many restrictions, disincentives, and taxes. In this book that Sylvia kindly mentioned, which is actually also by four people, I put the whole thing together, but we are four of us, we showed this in detail in each of the major form of you know, self-employment, usufruct, etc. And so all these restrictions, taxes, etc., impeded the advance of the private economy, conspiring against the needed growth that the government wanted. President Miguel Díaz-Canel is trapped by two things, by the guidelines of the Communist Party enacted in 2011 and by Raúl policies. So he has promised continuity. In my opinion, this is absurd. I mean, how could you have continuity with this huge crisis that you are confronting? Doesn't make any sense to me. And then I have a statement from Raúl basically acknowledging the crisis, saying that it won't be as bad as the crisis of the 1990s. He mentions only trade, diversification. I have mentioned all the reasons for that. So one would expect that in the latest legislation, the National Assembly of People's Power that was held last April, you will have a program, a very immediate program to confront the crisis. Yes, no. The majority of the discussion was related to the year, a long-term plan to 2030, for instance. By 2030, the Cuban government will secure to each Cuban citizen 35 pounds of tubers. I mean, we're not talking about 2030, we're talking about now. Now is, there is a problem. And most of the policies that are agreed by the National Assembly are all stuff, vague goals, you know, import substitution, industrialization. Okay, but how are you going to do it? You have been trying this for 60 years, you have no work. So what is new here? And it's the same policy, más de lo mismo. And I have very careful study what has been the reaction of Cuban economists who are in Cuba, not in here, in Cuba, about this strategy. Carranza, Monreal, Omar Berlini, Benavides, Ferrer, Morales, etc. And this is a summary of what they have said. First of all, ignores the huge obstacles that Cuba faces. Number two, the lack of imagination and daring to attack such problems. Number three, the inadequacy of the plan in view of the economic challenges that lie ahead. Number four, and this is very important, the absence in the discussion of the, quote, long-standing broad consensus on the economic reform inside of Cuba. So they are saying, we had a consensus for broader, deeper reforms, but it's not in the discussion there. We should be. And here is another one. The silence on the private property, this is said by Cuban economists, and microenterprises, which should be given priority. And the widespread scarcity of essential food items, which predict a second special period. Now, just last week, Díaz-Canel enacted the first of what he said would be a series of reforms. It was an increase of the nominal wage. And if you want to see what is this in real terms, go to my session tomorrow at 5, in which I will show that even with this, this is about 40% below real wages, meaning adjusted for inflation in 1989. So it's an important increase in nominal terms, but still, purchasing power is lower than in that year. And finally, and this is interesting, I have to say. In 1993, in the worst year of this depression, of this crisis, Fidel Castro, regretfully, because he didn't want really to do this, but he had to do it. The situation, it was a threat to the Cuban Revolution, and so he was willing to be pragmatic on this. He introduced a series of modest economic reforms. For instance, the circulation of the US dollar, opening to tourism, foreign investment, expansion of self-employment, opening of agricultural free markets. And these measures contain the crisis. The crisis lasted, but in 1994, there was a stagnation, and then very slowly a recovery, which have not yet recovered after all these years, but still that helped to improve the situation. So if Fidel did this in 1993, I ask, why the Cuban authorities doesn't do something similar now? And that's a big question. Of course, I cannot answer. We have to wait and see. Thank you very much.
I should announce that Manuel Cuesta Morua is not able to be with us, unfortunately. His visa is expected to be given to him next Monday. And so, unfortunately also, though, he only conveyed that to me yesterday afternoon. Had he done that earlier, we could have brought him in as a video, as Maria Werlau has done for Boris González Arenas. So unfortunately, he is not with us, which we regret. Since we do have more time than we usually have, I think that it would be nice if we first take questions, comments for Carmelo, and then we will do Mauricio, because Mauricio is going to speak in Spanish, and we can speak in Spanish. Okay, so let's have questions, comments, whatever you want to say about Carmelo's presentation. Yes, please, Mario González Corso.
Yes, hi, good morning.
Yeah, good idea.
Thank you. Good morning, And thank you, Carmelo, as always, for such a rich presentation. What caught my eye was the data you presented in the beginning about sugar. And I wrote down 75% of exports, I guess, in 1989, and 22% of GDP.
So 75% of exports and 22% of GDP, and then the replacement with services by 2018 of 80% of exports. I couldn't catch the GDP number, but then later on we have sugar output 82% lower than in 1989. So that I found quite interesting, and I wanted to ask you two things. Do you see a reversal of this trend in the future, maybe in the intermediate or long-term future? That's the first part of my question. The other part is, have you given some thought, as an economist, right, what would be required if that trend, the reversal of that trend, were to be desired in terms of, you know, investment, capital, labor, other inputs and all that. And the reason why sugar caught my attention, I write a little bit about agriculture sometimes, and I haven't really paid a lot of attention to sugar in recent years, but you know, sugar prices in the world market and the fact that sugar is tied to the Cuban economic and national identity. So hopefully you can elaborate on those questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mario. Well, Jorge Perez Lopez is going to give a presentation, I think on Saturday, right, on the sugar industry. But, you know, I don't want to avoid your question. Of course, there is a long history to this because Fidel Castro decided to restructure the sugar sector. And the idea was that we are going to shut down mills and we are going to shut down plantations, cane plantations, and we will be able to continue high output production, which, by the way, it reached 8.5 million tons after the disaster of the, well, it was in 2000, in 1970, but then there was a decline in the rest of the economy, but then they managed through mechanization to continue producing more than 8 million tons. And now we are talking about 1 million, 1.2 million. So this is a total disaster. Definitely, the idea of the whole restructuring of the sugar sector didn't work. And that was another of Fidel's decision as to produce 10 million tons in 2070 that was done without consulting the experts. Whether this is reversible, I think the machinery is in pretty bad shape. You can see that in the annual reports. They always attribute the low sugar production to problems of the mills. They are old, they have not been modernized. You had a problem of transportation. You no longer use cleaning the cane through the machines. And of course, there is a problem of oil. So all this have conspires against this, and all the Cuban economists agree that there is a serious decapitalization, not only of the sugar industry, but as all. When you saw the index of industrial output, you saw how that declined. It was impressive, and that continues today. There is a slight increase, but it will require a lot of foreign investment. And I don't have time to talk about this, but this is going very slowly. It's in cuenta gotas. There are like more than 400 proposals. I think about 50 have been approved. Most of them, I think 90%, are not in operation yet.
Somebody else? René Costales.
The microphone.
ahí te van a asistir. They're on the way.
One, two, three.
Mm-hmm.
While covering all the issues, you're using official statistics. You cover the oil, you cover the industrial production never recovered, but you don't have, you don't mention something very critical, food security and food sufficiency over the 60 years. And also, we know that during the 90s, the food supply was very, very constrained, and that was one of the key issues that the population really felt during the special period. Can you comment on current food sufficiency? You mentioned that there were some changes in the libreta recently, but other than that, is there more hard data? Is there more planning for that?
René, I have devoted a good part of my life dealing with Cuban statistics. By the way, Jorge Perez López had a paper on that that unfortunately have not been published. I would have been very honored if it is published in Cuban Studies. They call my work boring. And it's right. I mean, it's very boring. The first paper that I wrote on this was in 1969. It took two issues of Latin American Research Review, and Moreno Fraginal told me later when he came into exile that he translated that article in Spanish and circulated in Cuba to show the Cuban officials the problems that they were facing. That was one of the best news that I have received in my life, believe me. But I get this question constantly. And first of all, there is a retired professor from FIU, Thanks Heaven, that he questioned all our work. Not mine, I mean, all our work was based in faulty statistics. He ignored that all the articles that I have written evaluating Cuban statistics. But I think it would be silly to simply ignore all of this, because otherwise we won't be in the point that economic research in Cuba is. And also, you have forced Cuban economists to use data. And in order to answer our arguments, the critics have to use data. So that's for an introduction. I never said that industrial output recovered. I showed that despite the increase, it still is way below what it was in 1980. Count the years. I mean, we are 2019. So that's not, how many years since 1989? And it still is below. 30. Okay, now, you are talking about food security. And there was, you know, Sylvia was very generous because she gave me time, and then because unfortunately Morua the guy was not here, I have five more minutes. But there is a very thorough table in this article that I mentioned with Pavel. No, excuse me, that's another article that it was published in Cuba, and Cuba Posible was one of the last things that they did, and it was also reproduced later, Cuba y la Economía, which is a work which is quite favorable to the Cuban government. They reproduce the article there, in which I show that these 13 products, 1989 through 2017, and as I said, I mean, they reached a peak, and then they were below that peak in 2017, and seven of those 13 products were below the level of 1989. I am not talking about industry, I am talking about agriculture, cattle, and fishing. The number of cattle in Cuba used to be close to 7 million in 1967. The latest figure in the 2007 is 3 point something. What happened? So the scarcity of consumer goods that Cuba is facing now is a result of a disastrous economic policy. Pepin and Alvarez have written a lot about that. I don't want to compete with you on that issue. And the libreta, this is the thing. Raul Castro was able to take a lot of goods from the libreta, from the rationing book, because that is a thing that he promised. And what he did, once the item was out of the rationing book, it was sold at market prices. And the idea was you were going to move to a market. But that means as soon as you did that, the price, boom, went up. But the scarcity is such that then there is a lot of people are guardando, they are hoarding. And then they say, this is unequal, so everybody, we have a scarcity, we share a scarcity, everybody. Share poverty. And so they put it back in the libreta. And of course, as the situation worsens, I predict you are going to see more of that. Many of these goods that were free, libre, are going to go back to the rationable.
Lily Guerra.
Sorry, I didn't hear the name.
Lilian Guerra.
Lily está aquí.
Sí, aquí está. Realmente.
Y un poco tarde porque tuve un problema con mi hijo, perdóneme. Carmelo knows I'm his number one fan among a whole group of number one fans. I'm very interested on the island people have started calling los misterios de la vida. And the misterios de la vida are the last phenomenon of the disappearance
of certain goods.
Lily, put
the microphone más cerca. Put the microphone closer to your mouth.
Okay. So in the last year, I've gone 3 times in the last year, and it's been striking that there's this new category of items that have disappeared from the economy that people call los misterios de la vida, and that's like the code on the streets, right? So one that was in the news, it made the English language news, it was all over the place, I'm sure all of you know about it more than I, but the disappearance of wheat was really, really intense. Que no había pan. And there was this prediction of wheat riots and bread that there would be riots. Now, I witnessed, and there were photographs, and you can find it if you want to go back, in the Spanish language press in Europe, of people gathered, hundreds of people gathered, because the el pan por la libreta was something that was anchored in the early years of the special period, and you have to pay for it, but it was like 1 peso, it's 1 peso por pan. So it was 1 pan por persona, right, 1 for each person. So this was, it was not just an issue of anger, frustration, it was so long lasting, it was about 6 months, that in that 6 month period when I went twice, the first initial reaction everybody had was fear and frustration and anger. And then it was this logical belief generalized that it was deliberate on the part of the state to restrict access to wheat and to reduce the ability of people to get wheat generally in order to provoke the collapse of pizzerias. And anybody who's been to Cuba in the last 40 years knows that the number one most successful form of entrepreneurship in Cuba has been the establishment of pizzerias. And pizza has become, because it's cheap and it's easy to make, become like the national food, desgraciadamente. So that, to me, I wonder if you could address that, because I've never been able to answer the question. And this new analysis, que fue todo a propósito, you know, it is very true that at least in Santo Suarez, in Centro Havana, and Old Havana, you know, of the pizzerias that I knew, only 2 are still standing. And they were literally on every corner. You know, I mean, everybody had one, especially after the reforms that Raul put in place. So that, to me, is very, very unique, interesting, but it's one of many different disappearances, but that's the one that I think has been most intense in its political effects. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I have to repeat myself, but in the figure that I put about liquidity in the hands of the population, you have the same situation in the crisis of 1990s. When it reached 75% of GDP, that means there was a lot of money in circulation, surplus money, but you couldn't buy anything with it because there were no goods. Now, we are not in that situation yet, and maybe we won't, I don't know. But what I can see is the trend, and the trend is bad, because it's increasing and reaching the levels that we have in 1992 and 1994, right before and after the big disaster of 1993. And it's very interesting, this is an anecdote, but I think it's representative of what we know. We have people in Cuba sending money. Lately, they say, don't send me money, send me food. So more people are sending food packages rather than hiro por de dinero, money. Because the people, I know people who are in fairly good situation economically, and they do have not only CUC, the convertible peso, but also hard currency, they cannot find the stuff. Now, sometimes there is a huge, well, the list is very long, but rice, bread, chicken, oil. So they may solve one problem, but then the other one worsens. And the reason is very simple, is that the agricultural system doesn't work. I had a paper with Mario on usufructo, had a long way to go. It seems that when you are very critical, even scientifically and objectively, of the Cuban economy, you get all kinds of problems to get your work published in outstanding journals. Since heaven, I think it has been accepted finally. And we document this with Cuban statistics. Look, I mean, it's really bad. So what I can say, the reality probably is worse, but it's documented with their own data. It's a total disaster. I mean, and this is shown by this table again on 13 agricultural cattle and fishing products. And a pizzeria, of course, is part of the problem, because if you don't have harina, you cannot have pizzas. Yeah.
One last question on Carmelo's presentation, and that is Strauss, Michael.
Yes, thank you for the presentation. I'm curious, you had mentioned that if Maduro falls, there would not be any country really that could pick up the slack, that could fill the gap, and the subsidies and contribution to the Cuban economy. And you mentioned China, and I'm wondering how you arrived at that assessment that China is, for example, not able to. Because I would think otherwise, particularly in view of its increased or more intense competition with the United States and its geopolitical aims, that it would have both the capacity and perhaps the will to do this. And particularly, one of the things that it's been developing on a global basis in recent years is very heavy investments in the tourism sector, which is precisely one of the sectors that you mentioned is suffering in Cuba. Thank you.
Okay. Once again, you can find a lot of data on this in that article, which is in Canon webpage. Let me start with Russia. Putin will love to replace Venezuela. He will love it. I mean, he will have another weapon against the United States. But if you look at the Cuban statistics again, Russia ranks in 2017 eighth in terms of the major trade partners of Cuba. Eighth. The percentage in relation to the total is one digital. Now, the major problem here is that the most important source of hard currency for Cuba is the exportation of professional services, meaning mostly physicians, nurses, etc. But as I show, the salary paid to the state is seven times the average wage of a Venezuelan doctor. That is a hidden subsidy. Do you think that Putin is going to do that? Do you think he's going to go back to the 1980s when they were subsidizing the price of sugar, the price of nickel, the price of oil? Now they will be subsidizing the price of Cuban doctors. I don't think they would do that. They don't have the money for that. There is an additional small problem, which is that the Cuban physician will have to learn Russian. By the way, I must tell you a secret, not so much. My second language when I was doing the PhD was Russian.
That is a secret.
it was a torture, believe me. And I did it because my dissertation was dealing with trying to disclaim the idea that socialist economy, you have full employment. And Russia was one case, Yugoslavia, North China, and Cuba. And I wanted to do research in the library of the Instituto de Estudios Latinoamericanos in Moscow. The first time, they didn't allow me to use it. I was there in 1980. The second time, I was with a program, an exchange program, with Professor Cole Blazer, and I went there. Of course, my Russian by then was even worse than, than when I finished. But, you know, I could read the statistics, and I said, my goodness, I wasted all my time, because there was garbage there, really. Compared with data in Europe and the United States, there was nothing that I could learn from, from that library in Cuba. So it's very difficult, very difficult. And finally, but not the least important, Cuba was selling Russia what? Sugar? Nickel? Fishing? What? I mean, sugar. 1.2 million tons? No way. Fishing is, I don't know, 90% below the 1989 level. So, nickel increased and then declined. It has been declining in the last 7 years. So how are they going to pay for exports of oil and many other things that Cuba needs? No way. China. Okay, yeah, but I think it's very important because strategically speaking, I think the Russians will be even more, not that the Chinese are not interested, particularly with the situation in terms of the tariff with President Trump. China is a second trade partner of Cuba.
It's already there.
Yeah, but look, the second trade partner makes 9% of total Cuban trade. In 1 year, it was the first one. But not because the trade increased, it's because 1 year declined Venezuela, and then the following year, still Venezuela is the first trade partner. And the volume of trade of China increased a little bit in 2017. We don't know 2018 because they are not available. But it was back to a peak 7 years before. The Chinese companies are relatively independent. The Cuban government is not dealing with the Russian government. It's dealing with enterprises that in China, excuse me, Chinese government, enterprises in China that have relative autonomy. And they are business people. They are doing business. The only thing that Cuba sells to China is 400,000 tons of sugar. And believe me, the Chinese are quite rigid about getting that sugar. Cuba have had to go out and buy sugar in order to comply with the trade agreement with China. Then, again, what is going Cuba to sell to China? What? Export professional physicians. If Russian is difficult, I mean, I never tried to learn Chinese, of course, but Chinese will be an insurmountable barrier. And there is a technical problem, too. China doesn't have a public and universal free healthcare system as Cuba does, although deteriorated in quality and access. They have a mixed system in which you have co-payments. The whole thing of sending physicians to Cuba to China, no way. And then there have been a series of agreements between China and Cuba, but we are talking about 160 million, 200 million. Compare this with the relationship of China and investment, direct investment of China in Latin America, Argentina. There was an article recently in the New York Times about that. There is no comparison, really. So my answer is no way.
Thank you, Carmelo. Muchas gracias. There is a lot more exposure to Carmelo in this program because he's also giving another paper, and also Friday night there is a documentary on his life via interviews, and I think you will find it very interesting.
I talk about statistics there.
You talk about Russia and China too. I want to take advantage of a moment to introduce you to this painting, El Sombrero de Yarey. As you can see, it has the ASCII logo in it. I actually commissioned this from two very dear artists who are dear friends of mine, Aldo Menendez and his wife, Yvonne Ferrer. And we went back and forth with respect to the, you know, the actual painting. I think it's very beautiful. I think it's very abstract. You can read into it whatever you want, but it has El Sombrero de Yarey, is what the Mambises fighting for Cuban independence in the 19th century used to use. Cuba is still fighting for independence, I think, in many ways. And then it's on, you know, an old colonial architecture with a lamp that is hanging. It sort of looks like El Segundo Cabo in La Habana. So, and it has the ASCII logo, okay? So it was intended to be a fundraiser for ASCII. And if anybody is interested, I will give you the sheet that you can then fill out and order. You can order an affiche, a poster, which is a reproduction, regular poster size for $40. Or you can order a silk screen serigrafía that is a limited and numbered edition and will be signed by both artists, and that is $250. Or you can order even the original painting, a bigger size than this one, in acrylic on canvas, signed by both artists, and that would be $2,000 and would include a certificate of authenticity. Okay. So far, ASCII has not spent a penny on this. It's me who has spent the penny. but all the proceeds will go to ASCII's general operating expenses. So if you want to help us out, there's a poster, there is a silk screen, or there's an original painting, and it's very beautiful, I think. I really love it. Okay, so now let's switch to Spanish, okay? Con Mauricio de Miranda Parrondo. Mauricio is with us, thanks to, again, the many people who stepped up and made it possible for us to bring the people that we wanted to bring here as guests. Mauricio es doctor en Economía Internacional y Desarrollo por la Universidad Complutense de Madrid. También es licenciado en Economía por la Universidad de La Habana. Fue profesor asociado en la Universidad Complutense de Madrid. Actualmente es profesor titular del Departamento de Economía y director del Centro de Estudios sobre la Cuenca del Pacífico de la Pontificia Universidad Javeriana en Cali, Colombia, donde trabaja desde 1990, muchos años. En la Universidad Javeriana es profesor de Historia Económica Mundial en los cursos de pregrado y de Entorno Económico Internacional en posgrado. En Cuba, él fue investigador en el Centro de Investigaciones sobre la Economía Mundial, CIEM, y también investigador de mercados internacionales en el Fondo Cubano de Bienes Culturales. Fue también profesor adjunto en la Facultad de Economía de la Universidad de La Habana y en el Instituto Superior de Relaciones Internacionales de La Habana. Es autor de varios artículos y capítulos de libros sobre la economía cubana y sobre relaciones económicas internacionales entre América Latina y Asia. Es autor del texto Los problemas de la inserción internacional de Cuba y su relación con el desarrollo económico. Ha sido editor y compilador, además de coautor de varios libros, tales como Reforma Económica y Cambio Social en América Latina y el Caribe, cuatro casos de estudios, Colombia, Cuba, Costa Rica y México. Otro libro se llama Alternativas de Política Económica y Social en América Latina y el Caribe. Y aún más libros, hay uno que se llama Cuba, Reestructuración Económica y Globalización, otro que se llama Cuba, Sociedad, Cultura y Política en Tiempos de Globalización. Otro que se llama, yo no sé cómo tiene tiempo de escribir tanto, otro que se llama Cuba hacia una estrategia de desarrollo para los inicios del siglo XXI. Y aún más, otro que se llama Las relaciones económicas entre América Latina y Asia hacia la construcción de una nueva inserción internacional. Su investigación sobre Cuba se ha centrado en los problemas del desarrollo económico, la política económica y la inserción económica internacional del país, y dentro de esto ha abordado también la perspectiva comparada. Eso me parece muy importante. También se ha dedicado al estudio de los procesos de reformas económicas, desarrollo e inserción internacional de países asiáticos con economías emergentes, muy especialmente los casos de China y Vietnam, así como los problemas económicos del socialismo. Okay, ayúdenme.
First of all, thank you to ASCII for the invitation. It's a pleasure. It's an immense pleasure for me to participate in this conference. Obviously, I prefer to speak Spanish. Y quiero hablar hoy sobre un tema que en el que he venido insistiendo desde hace muchísimo rato, cuando comenzó la discusión sobre la nueva constitución, en la que por primera vez se dijo que las opiniones de los cubanos residentes fuera de Cuba serían tomadas en cuenta en el análisis. Al menos puedo asegurar que las mías no fueron tomadas en cuenta. Y quiero hablar concretamente de la economía política y las relaciones de propiedad en la nueva Constitución cubana. Dicho sea de paso, no solo las mías no fueron tomadas en cuenta, no fueron tomadas en cuenta muchas de las opiniones expresadas por los cubanos residentes en Cuba en asambleas públicas. Fueron tomadas en cuenta algunas. Algunas las que eran un poco complicadas. ¿Dónde están las cuestiones de las relaciones de propiedad en la nueva Constitución? Están en el título 2 dedicado a los fundamentos económicos. Concretamente, el artículo 18 establece claramente que rige un sistema de economía socialista basado en la propiedad de todo el pueblo, las comillas son mías, sobre los medios fundamentales de producción como la forma de propiedad principal, y la dirección planificada de la economía que tiene en cuenta, regula y controla el mercado en función de los intereses de la sociedad, también debía haber puesto comillas. Y luego en el artículo 19 dice que el Estado dirige, regula y controla la actividad económica conciliando los intereses nacionales, territoriales, colectivos e individuales en beneficio de la sociedad. Adicionalmente, deja claro que la planificación socialista constituye el componente central del sistema de dirección del desarrollo económico y social. Y un poco más adelante, en el artículo 22, se reconocen como formas de propiedad las siguientes. La socialista de todo el pueblo, que es en la que el Estado actúa en representación y beneficio de aquel como propietario. Esto tiene mucho de ancho como de largo. En realidad, se nos está diciendo que la propiedad de todo el pueblo es la propiedad del Estado. Y se nos está diciendo que el Estado representa los intereses de la sociedad. La pregunta es, ¿qué tan bien representa el Estado? O más bien, ¿quién maneja el Estado, que es el gobierno, a la sociedad cubana? Y si la representa bien, ¿de qué manera esa propiedad del Estado muestra altísimos niveles de ineficiencia? Muestra unos resultados económicos lamentables que Carmelo ha explicado magistralmente, como siempre nos tiene acostumbrados. La propiedad cooperativa, que aparece como un asidero de una forma de propiedad social sin ser propiamente del Estado, y que se sustenta en el trabajo colectivo de los socios propietarios y en el ejercicio de los principios del cooperativismo. Sin embargo, históricamente, las cooperativas que originalmente eran solamente agrícolas y que hoy en día se permite que sean cooperativas no agropecuarias, es decir, en otras actividades, han estado históricamente muy controladas por el Estado, e incluso en el caso de las cooperativas agrícolas, incluso el Estado les imponía planes económicos. También hay propiedades de las organizaciones sociales, políticas y de masas, que la verdad nunca ha quedado claro cómo las adquirieron. La propiedad privada, finalmente, y se decide, y se define, perdón, que es la propiedad que se ejerce sobre determinados medios de producción por personas naturales o jurídicas cubanas o extranjeras, con un papel complementario en la economía, y lo pongo claramente en negrilla, porque la Constitución es clara en definir que la propiedad privada sobre los medios de producción tiene solo una función secundaria, complementaria. Y a lo largo de todas las discusiones y en todas las reuniones de la Asamblea Nacional y en las discusiones en torno a la Constitución y recientemente, cuando se adoptaron o se anunciaron las medidas, las nuevas medidas, los nuevos cambios de los cuales voy a hablar finalmente al final de mi presentación, siempre se ha mantenido ese papel secundario, ese papel complementario de la propiedad privada sobre los medios de producción. Y bueno, además se definen otras como la personal, la de las instituciones, las mixtas. Y hay un acápite, hay una afirmación que se repite sucesivamente en la Constitución, sobre todo en lo referido a los derechos, pero no me voy a referir a eso en mi presentación, y es que la ley regula lo relativo al ejercicio y alcance de las formas de propiedad. Es decir, la Constitución le deja un amplísimo margen a la ley, que tiene un nivel jurídico inferior a la Constitución, para que sea la que regule el ejercicio de esas formas de propiedad. Y define claramente, en los artículos 23 al 27, cuáles son aquellos sectores que solamente podrán estar dentro de la propiedad socialista. Aclara que las tierras pertenecientes las tierras no pertenecientes a particulares o a cooperativistas, todo el subsuelo, los yacimientos minerales, los bosques, los recursos naturales, las aguas, las playas, etc. Y además de eso, define, y esto es muy interesante, sobre todo a la luz de las últimas medidas económicas del gobierno, que el trabajo es un valor primordial de la sociedad y que el trabajo debe ser la fuente principal de los ingresos, que sustenta condiciones de vida dignas, permite elevar el bienestar material y espiritual y la realización de los proyectos individuales, colectivos y sociales. Y como todos sabemos, en Cuba, además de un tema de escasez generalizada de bienes de consumo, hay un problema grave de ingresos, que la población ha arrastrado una brecha entre los ingresos y el costo de la vida, una brecha que se vuelve insalvable en las condiciones actuales y que solamente está resolviendo las remesas o las fuentes de ingreso suplementario desde el exterior. Bien, entonces la primera pregunta que vale la pena hacerse: ¿es realmente de todo el pueblo la propiedad que el Estado gestiona en su representación? En realidad, históricamente, y esto viene desde el mismo surgimiento del socialismo como sistema económico, desde la revolución de bolchevique y el establecimiento del socialismo en los países de Europa Oriental y en algunos de Asia, y es que la propiedad la llamada propiedad de todo el pueblo tiene serios problemas en su realización. Nadie discute que la propiedad privada sobre los medios de producción tiene una realización asegurada. Y esa realización asegurada está precisamente en los beneficios obtenidos por quien invierte en un negocio privado. ¿De qué manera los supuestos propietarios colectivos pueden ejercer un control sobre la propiedad que supuestamente es de ellos? Un capitalista, un propietario privado, ejerce el control sobre su propiedad. Tiene todas las condiciones para ejercer el control sobre su propiedad. En cambio, en los países comunistas, en Cuba específicamente, nunca los propietarios colectivos han tenido la capacidad de controlar la gestión sobre su supuesta propiedad. Entre otras cosas, porque tampoco se goza de un sistema democrático desde el punto de vista de las relaciones políticas. Entonces, como no hay una democracia política, no existe un control sobre el poder que es quien ejecuta efectivamente la propiedad. Entonces vienen toda una serie de preguntas: ¿de qué forma gestiona la propiedad los supuestos propietarios? ¿De qué forma controlan los supuestos propietarios colectivos a aquellos que gestionan esa propiedad en su nombre, como es el gobierno? Además, la Constitución cubana lo define claramente, es decir, el Estado representa al pueblo en la gestión de esa propiedad. Y al no existir democracia, y al no existir control del elector sobre el gobierno, se rompe toda posibilidad para ejercer un control sobre la propiedad que ese gobierno gestiona. Históricamente, la llamada propiedad sobre los medios de producción, social sobre los medios de producción, ha tenido serios problemas. Serios problemas que han afectado la eficacia del sistema económico socialista. ¿Es la propiedad de todos o es la propiedad de nadie? Porque si nadie puede ejercer control sobre la propiedad, si no existe una relación directa de intereses económicos respecto a la gestión de esa propiedad, ¿de qué forma puede ese supuesto propietario estar interesado en la eficiencia de la gestión o en la eficacia de la gestión de esa propiedad? No existen los suficientes incentivos económicos y realmente, si uno hiciera un análisis de largo plazo, todos sabemos que durante prácticamente 30 años en la Revolución Cubana, en la llamada Revolución Cubana, se insistió en el problema de los incentivos morales como movilizadores sociales en el país. Y la ineficacia de esos incentivos ha quedado demostrada por la historia económica de Cuba. Y cuando se ha pretendido establecer incentivos económicos, estos han sido frenados de tal manera que no han funcionado adecuadamente como incentivos económicos. En general, es triste, pero uno observa cómo, además de problemas serios en las políticas económicas del gobierno, y siendo un país con muy escasos recursos, en Cuba la dilapidación de los recursos económicos es una norma. Es decir, en Cuba se dilapidan los recursos. Los niveles de uso de materias primas, de bienes intermedios, muestran un bajísimo nivel de competitividad, además de una gran obsolescencia tecnológica. Esto conduce a una baja productividad del trabajo. Hay una excesiva centralización en la toma de decisiones. Es llamativo que ahora se ha anunciado como un descubrimiento increíble, que se podrá hacer una planificación desde abajo. Así lo decía recientemente el ministro de Economía, Alejandro Gil. Bueno, todavía no es claro cómo se va a hacer esa planificación desde abajo. Entre otras cosas, porque históricamente la planificación cubana ha sido por decreto. Y los ministerios, empezando por el Ministerio de Economía, la antigua Junta Central de Planificación, y pasando por todos los ministerios, han entregado a las empresas siempre cifras directivas. Supuestamente eso ya no va a ocurrir de esa manera, sino que las empresas podrán planificar desde abajo. Pregunta muy importante. ¿Cómo puede planificar una empresa que no tiene control real sobre sus propios recursos? Porque no tiene control real sobre sus propios recursos. En general, la escasez de recursos del Estado afecta a los sectores que dependen del Estado. Es decir, las empresas estatales cuentan con muy pocos recursos, el Estado en general cuenta con muy pocos recursos. La tasa de inversión en la economía cubana, y contando con que la inversión estatal es la mayoritaria, es una tasa absurda. Realmente es una tasa que está en el orden del 13 al 14% del Producto Interior Bruto. Y eso está demostrando una incapacidad para poder asegurar el crecimiento económico a través de la inversión. Y las experiencias de los países que han tenido altos ritmos de crecimiento económico, China, Vietnam, países de Asia Oriental, la misma India en los últimos años, muestran unas tasas de acumulación considerablemente altas, que están por encima del 30%, en el caso de China, como todos sabemos, llegan casi al 50%. Cuba tiene una tasa de acumulación de entre el 13 y el 14%. Y al final, tenemos un serio problema, que es el de la adecuada elección en la toma de decisiones. El sistema es tremendamente centralizado, el centro de poder toma las decisiones y no siempre o casi nunca las decisiones se toman partiendo de una racionalidad económica, sino partiendo, uno podría decir, de una racionalidad política, sí, pero es sobre todo las racionalidades del poder. Toda decisión que pueda contribuir a la erosión del poder es desechada, por necesaria que resulte para asegurar el crecimiento. Por tanto, lo más importante es la conservación del poder. Y partiendo de eso, pues claro, si se producen decisiones que democraticen la economía, pues obviamente eso va a erosionar el poder. Vemos unos datos que resultan muy llamativos. Cuba tiene aproximadamente un total de ocupados en la economía nacional de casi 4 millones y medio de personas, de los cuales 3 millones están ocupados en el sector estatal, y en el sector privado solamente aparecen 910 mil, de los cuales más de la mitad son por cuenta propia. Los otros son campesinos, etc. Aquí aprovecho para apoyar lo que Carmelo decía sobre el tema de las estadísticas. Estamos en julio, finalizando julio de 2019. La Oficina Nacional de Estadística e Información de Cuba está empezando a publicar algunos capítulos del anuario de 2018. Cuando ya estamos en el segundo semestre del 2019, hay una serie de capítulos del 2018. Y el único con información económica que ha sido publicado es el de la industria manufacturera. ni siquiera el de la población. Y por supuesto no las cuentas nacionales, que son las últimas que se publican. Y por supuesto no el sector externo, que también es de los últimos que se publican. Y por supuesto no la balanza de pagos, que no la conocemos desde hace 3 años. Y para eso solamente la cuenta corriente, ni siquiera la cuenta de capital y financiera. ¿Por qué? ¿Por qué ese secretismo? Las cifras no deben estar muy bien cuando no se informan. Y obviamente, pues, podrán señalar algunas autoridades cubanas que no quieren que se conozca la difícil situación financiera del país y por eso no se publica la cuenta de capital y financiera. Sí, pero es que para recibir inversiones y para recibir préstamos necesita el inversionista y el prestamista saber en qué condiciones está la economía para pagar o no. Porque de lo contrario, no. Y Cuba tiene una larga historia de incumplimientos de pagos, sobre todo incluso con el famoso certificado de liquidez, porque ni siquiera tiene la liquidez suficiente para asegurar que los inversionistas puedan convertir su CUC en moneda dura de verdad. Como vemos en estas estadísticas, el sector privado, si bien ha crecido en los últimos años de una manera importante, tiene todavía limitaciones, no constituye todavía un sector determinante en el empleo, aunque va creciendo notablemente, y va creciendo y no crece más por las restricciones que existen en Cuba para el empleo por cuenta propia. Normalmente uno pensaría que la regulación estatal debería señalar qué actividades, si las hubiera, no deberían ser por cuenta propia. En el caso de Cuba no es así. En el caso de Cuba hay una lista de actividades que se pueden hacer. Uno pensaría, la lógica indicaría que todo lo que no esté prohibido está permitido. En Cuba, todo lo que no está permitido está prohibido. La lógica es diferente. Y esto hace que realmente se vuelva un proceso kafkiano todo el intento de abrir negocios y sostener negocios. La propiedad privada no cuenta con reconocimiento a sus potencialidades como motor del crecimiento económico. Hoy por hoy, con las medidas del gobierno que voy a relacionar más adelante, hoy por hoy el sector privado no cuenta con las condiciones legales suficientes para constituir un negocio que pueda tener perspectiva en el mediano y largo plazo. Porque sobre el negocio, sobre el sector privado cubano pende siempre la espada de Damocles. Porque incluso en las medidas actuales se puede permitir una cierta integración, y lo digo con comillas, del sector privado con el sector público o el sector estatal, pero siempre bajo el control del sector estatal. Constitucionalmente solo se les reconoce un carácter complementario. El sistema cubano y el sistema legal cubano, y esto seguramente hablarán mucho mejor que yo los abogados, por ahí he visto a Gabilondo, estoy seguro que van a hablar mucho mejor que yo de estos temas jurídicos. Pero realmente la realidad cubana es de una debilidad institucional tremenda. Allí no funciona, es decir, no hay un funcionamiento adecuado de la ley, porque la ley puede ser cambiada muy fácilmente y muy rápidamente. Y además de eso, medidas legales de menor categoría pueden reemplazar medidas legales de mayor categoría, algo nunca visto en la historia. Hay una ausencia de legislación que proteja los derechos del sector privado. En Vietnam, por ejemplo, los vietnamitas crearon una ley de empresa. Y la ley de empresa es clarísima en darle a la empresa privada de Vietnam los mismos derechos que la empresa estatal. Exactamente los mismos. No define que ninguna sea predominante. Hay una gran incertidumbre. La gran incertidumbre está llevando en la práctica de los negocios privados en Cuba a un fenómeno que es muy negativo. Y es que el inversionista, como sobre él pende permanentemente la espada de Damocles, y la espada de Damocles puede ser una inspección municipal, o puede ser una terminación de sus licencias, o puede ser una nueva norma que no renueve licencias, etcétera, etcétera, etcétera. Entonces, sencillamente, el emprendedor cubano trata, obviamente, de recuperar su inversión cuanto antes. Y esto genera un serio problema, porque normalmente las inversiones no se recuperan de hoy para mañana. Para recuperarse de hoy para mañana, los precios tienen que ser altísimos. Y esa es una realidad que se vive en Cuba, donde muchos de los precios de los servicios que ofrecen los trabajadores privados no guardan relación alguna con el nivel de ingresos de la población. Y finalmente, pues el Estado, como todos sabemos, controla y asfixia al sector privado de una manera sistemática. ¿Cuáles han sido las medidas anunciadas recientemente por el presidente Díaz-Canel y también comentadas por el ministro de Economía, Alejandro Gil? Por cierto, voy a hacer un comercial que no es para mí, obviamente, es decir, yo no me hago comerciales, sino voy a recomendar un video que está en YouTube y está en Facebook, los que tienen Facebook, de una comparecencia en televisión recientemente de José Luis Rodríguez, exministro de Economía de Cuba y actual asesor del Centro de Investigaciones sobre la Economía Mundial, y que fue mi antiguo jefe allí, y Oscarito Fernández, un fantástico joven economista, profesor de la Universidad de La Habana, quienes abordan algunos temas relacionados con las medidas y lo hacen con una gran independencia de criterio y con una solvencia fantástica. Así que recomiendo ese video. Luego, no sé, podrán colocar, es un programa que se llama En Cuba Hoy o algo así, pero en fin, es muy interesante. ¿Cuáles han sido las medidas recientes? Aumento de salarios en el sector presupuestado. Cuando esta medida salió, varios de nosotros, y cuando digo nosotros me refiero a varios economistas de aquí y de allá, es decir, de ambos lados del mar, empezamos a discutir el tema. Porque uno de los anuncios de Díaz-Canel fue: no habrá aumento de precios. Y quien ha estudiado un curso básico de economía sabe que cuando se aumenta la oferta monetaria sin aumentar la producción, el resultado es aumento de precios. No hay de otra. Claro, el gobierno cubano acostumbrado a adoptar medidas administrativas dice: no subirán los precios, los vamos a topar. Como si las medidas de tope de precios que se han impuesto a lo largo de 60 años hubieran sido efectivas. Hace unos años decidieron topar los precios de los servicios de los llamados almendrones. Me imagino que todo el mundo sabrá lo que es un almendrón, un automóvil viejo de los años 40 o 50 que ofrece servicios de taxi. Bueno, pues desaparecieron los almendrones. Porque también en un curso básico de economía se aprende que cuando se fija un precio que está por debajo de la oferta y la demanda, sencillamente lo que se produce es escasez. Escasez. El producto sale del mercado y comienza a desarrollarse el mercado negro, el mercado subterráneo.
que hay un libro muy interesante de Jorge sobre eso en Cuba, hace años. El aumento de salarios, ya esta es mi última, es el último, la última diapositiva. El aumento de salarios solamente abarca el sector presupuestario. Representa en la práctica un promedio de 4 CUC para cada trabajador. Eso es insuficiente. Es insuficiente para asegurar las necesidades de la economía. Las necesidades de satisfacción, es decir, las necesidades de la gente, de su consumo, de su consumo. No iba a pensar en el ahorro. El aumento para los pensionados, que es una cantidad similar a las que se benefician con el aumento de salarios de los trabajadores presupuestados, es claramente exiguo. Más o menos unos 40 pesos cubanos por persona. Se habla de desarrollo de instituciones financieras para apoyar créditos en divisas para el sector estatal, a través de la experiencia que ya hubo con Finatur. Las empresas retendrán total o parcialmente ingresos en divisas obtenidos por el sobrecumplimiento de las exportaciones planificadas y se supone que esto debe ser un incentivo a exportar más. Se eliminan las restricciones en las relaciones entre empresas estatales y empresas no estatales con el objetivo de lograr mayores encadenamientos productivos, pero observen, relaciones entre empresas estatales y empresas no estatales. Varias empresas podrán importar bienes necesarios para el desarrollo de productos exportables. Y además se va a pagar parte de las utilidades obtenidas en algunas empresas, se va a aumentar ese pago. Y finalmente se habla de mecanismos para que las formas de gestión no estatal puedan exportar a través de entidades estatales. Resumiendo, yo señalaría que la nueva Constitución no resuelve satisfactoriamente los problemas relacionados con las relaciones de propiedad y el funcionamiento de la economía cubana. El dogmatismo ideológico parece primar sobre la necesidad de enfrentar las realidades objetivas de la economía a costa del crecimiento económico y del bienestar social, y esto es histórico. Y finalmente se nos presenta entonces una contradicción seria. El Estado no cuenta con recursos suficientes para asegurar la satisfacción de la demanda, pero se resiste a permitir que el sector privado asuma las actividades que el Estado no puede desarrollar. Muchas gracias.
Déjeme decirles que el Wi-Fi de aquí es se conecta a Hilton, rayita meeting, rayita PSAB, y el código es ASCII 2019, el password. Emilio, un par de preguntas nada más porque ya estamos tarde para el café. Sí. Emilio Morales.
Buenas a todos. ¿Se oye? ¿Ahora? Bueno, primero que todo, felicito a Mauricio, no lo conozco personalmente, pero felicito por esta magistral conferencia que acaba de dar. Y a Carmelo igual, Carmelo siempre, como siempre, muy preciso en sus observaciones. Mirando estas dos conferencias y mirando todo lo que está pasando, lo que ha ocurrido en los últimos 2 años, parece que vamos al caos. Esta gente está empujando el país al caos porque yo no veo soluciones factibles por ninguna parte. Todos son disparates. Alejandro Gil le está haciendo honor a su apellido. Es un estúpido. Entonces, yo lo que estoy viendo es una tormenta perfecta que se acerca con una bola de nieve. ¿Quién para esto? ¿A dónde vamos, Mauricio?
si quieres a todo.
¿Alguien más? Sí, no. Ah, bueno, Tenis Delgado y Sergio Díaz Briquet. Y ya después de eso estamos tarde para el café.
También quiero agradecer las excelentes presentaciones y quería tomarle la palabra a Mauricio con esa el comercial que hizo sobre la comparecencia del profesor José Luis Rodríguez y Oscar Fernández. Yo estuve viendo los debates que se produjeron. Yo estuve viendo los debates que se produjeron en Facebook hace un día, ayer, y me parecieron muy interesantes unas preguntas que estaba presentando Pedro Monreal, y quería saber cuál es su opinión sobre eso. Él decía que ¿qué es lo que debería de ser la solución para el desarrollo de cuentapropismo en Cuba? ¿Si una mayor o una mejor integración al modelo económico que existe ahora mismo, o si tomar nuevas medidas particularmente para el desarrollo de la iniciativa privada?
Sergio, ¿dónde está Sergio?
Ah. No sé si se oye.
Sí, habla alto.
Muy agradecida a las dos presentaciones, me uno a Emilio. Mi pregunta es para Mauricio, que pone muy interesante el análisis, pero una cosa que dijiste que me impresionó, que comparaste con Vietnam, donde me dice que hay paridad entre la relación del sector privado y el sector estatal. Pero me pregunto, si el sistema es similar al de Cuba, la Constitución no vale el papel donde está escrito. ¿Hasta qué punto la Constitución de Cuba quiere decir algo? ¿Y hasta qué punto la Constitución de Vietnam quiere decir algo si hay otras prioridades que toman precedencia sobre lo que tú?
Bueno, muchas gracias por los comentarios. Emilio, creo que te voy a defraudar. Yo no puedo saber a dónde va Cuba. Tendría que tener una bola de cristal y eso es realmente imposible. Yo sí creo que la situación económica no va a mejorar con las medidas actuales. Voy a vincular este análisis con lo que había planteado Denise. Justamente anoche fue que yo tuve tiempo de entrar también en el debate en Facebook sobre el tema de las medidas y apoyé la posición de Monreal. Esto es algo que hemos venido hablando durante mucho tiempo y tenemos clarísimo, estoy hablando en plural, pero bueno, es algo que realmente hemos discutido sobre todo Monreal y yo y Pavel y Everleni y es que es necesario, bueno, primero que todo, y esta es una de las críticas más serias que yo le he hecho siempre a las medidas de cambios cubanos, a los cambios cubanos, y es que nunca aparecen como un programa sistémico de reforma, sino son medidas parciales. Van poco a poco, tratando de apagar fuego, tratando de tapar un hueco. Y así no funciona la cosa. Y así no funcionó en China, así no funcionó en Vietnam, así no ha funcionado en ningún lugar y no va a funcionar en Cuba. Y ellos siguen apelando a esa norma, a la norma de tomar medidas parciales. Por ejemplo, Oscarito y José Luis decían, esto no se resuelve hasta que no se unifique la moneda y no se unifique la tasa de cambio. Y entonces viene el problema. Muy bien, ¿y cuál es la tasa de cambio? Bueno, José Luis hablaba de una tasa de cambio que estaría entre 10, 15, es decir, una tasa de cambio mucho más baja que la actual. Yo no estoy de acuerdo con eso. El peso convertible no tiene ningún tipo de respaldo. No hay reservas internacionales suficientes para respaldar el CUC. Por lo tanto, no queda otro remedio que devaluar. Devaluar incluso el CUC. O lo que sería lo mismo, devaluar el peso cubano. Y bueno, y no voy a entrar aquí en el detalle de hasta dónde, porque eso no se puede saber, eso lo sabe el mercado, porque el mercado es el que permite fijar los precios relativos y eso es lo que nunca se ha logrado en Cuba, y hasta que no se fijen los precios, se establezcan precios relativos, no es posible comparar el valor relativo de las monedas. Entonces el criterio nuestro ha sido, hace falta una reforma sistémica, que signifique la plena libertad para el funcionamiento del sector privado. El sector privado en Cuba en estos momentos es el único que puede convertirse en el motor del crecimiento económico y eso no lo reconoce el gobierno. El gobierno reconoce que el sector estatal va a seguir siendo el motor impulsor del crecimiento económico y eso es un error craso. Es un error craso porque en el sector estatal hay serios problemas de financiamiento, serios problemas de obsolescencia tecnológica y no hay manera de salir adelante en las condiciones actuales. Además de que padecen de un abultamiento en lo que podría llamarse un sobreempleo. Es decir, hay gente de más trabajando en el sector estatal. Si el sector privado cobra dinámica, hacia el sector privado podrían desplazarse trabajadores que hoy en día están en el sector estatal. El sector privado podría competir con el sector estatal. Un día alguien, bueno, creo que fue Machado Ventura, quien dijo, es que Cuba no puede tener un sistema de internet amplio porque el Estado no tiene recursos para establecer toda la infraestructura. Muy bien. ¿Y quién le dijo a Machado Ventura que el Estado tiene que hacer eso? En todos los lugares del mundo lo hacen empresas privadas. Lo que hay es que abrir suficientemente la competencia para que no se cree una situación de monopolio privado y que el monopolio estatal no se reemplace por un monopolio privado. Ahora, pues obviamente uno comprende también las limitaciones de los colegas en Cuba, en un programa de televisión, para decir sus criterios, ¿no? No obstante eso, yo creo que fueron expresados con independencia y con muchísima solvencia teórica e incluso considerando los aspectos políticos, porque incluso recuerdo que Oscarito citó hasta Friedrich Hayek en su intervención, lo cual es muy llamativo, que no se cite a Marx o a Lenin, sino a Friedrich Hayek. Entonces, con respecto a Vietnam, bueno, no sé si respondo. ¿Y hacia dónde vamos? Bueno, mira, Emilio, yo creo que va muy mal la cosa, muy mal. Con respecto a Vietnam, sí, es interesante, es muy interesante. A ver, Vietnam tiene muchos problemas y uno de los grandes problemas que tiene Vietnam es la corrupción. Yo he hecho investigación de campo en Vietnam, he estado 3 veces en Vietnam, he entrevistado empresarios, empresarias, muy importante esto, empresarias, cabeza de familia, que exportan además. Y cuando les he preguntado cuál es el principal problema que enfrentan, la respuesta siempre ha sido la corrupción. Es decir, los empresarios en Vietnam tienen que enfrentar fenómenos de corrupción, tienen que pagar por debajo de la mesa para que les renueven las licencias, para que les autoricen el uso del suelo, para que no les cierren un negocio también. En fin, este tipo de cosas pasa. Por eso Vietnam no está muy bien calificado en el Doing Business ni en el Index of Corruption. Pero de todas maneras, la ley claramente le permite al empresario privado funcionar siempre que cumpla con todas las regulaciones que tiene que hacer, impositivas, etcétera, etcétera, etcétera. O sea, el régimen político es el mismo, pero en realidad el empresario privado puede desarrollar sus negocios sin ningún problema porque lo protege la ley. En Cuba no hay una ley de esa naturaleza. Esa es la diferencia.
Muchas gracias. El cafecito los espera allá afuera y después vuelven. Gracias.